Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu an la ilaha أشهد أن محمد رسول الله.
الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له وما يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وبعد خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. We begin by praising Allah, we praise Him, we seek His help and we ask for His forgiveness. We seek refuge with Allah from the evil of ourselves and from the evil consequences of our evil actions. Whomsoever Allah guides, there is none to misguide. And whomsoever Allah leaves to go astray, there is none to guide. And I testify and I bear witness that Allah alone is worthy of worship and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the worshipper of Allah and His final messenger. After that, the best speech is the Book of Allah, and the best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May God's peace and blessings be upon him. And the worst of all the affairs in the religion are those matters that have been newly introduced. And every newly introduced matter in the religion is an innovation. All of the innovations are misguidance. All the misguidance is going astray. And all the going astray is in the fire. My brothers and sisters in Islam, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy upon you. As all of us know, or all of us should know, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has created us for the purpose of worshipping Him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He told us, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. That Allah, He created the human beings and the jinn for no other purpose except إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, except to make ibadah towards Him. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made this world in which we live and this life that we have a testing ground. To see those who will disobey and those who will obey. To make known the true believers and the faithful servants from those who disbelieve and rebel. To distinguish between the pious and the sinful. And the greatest treasure and the best thing, my brothers and sisters, that you can acquire is true iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The best thing that you can have and the best provision with which you can provide yourself is taqwa. To be mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And iman is something that increases and decreases. Iman increases with obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it decreases with disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the reality of Iman, because in this religion, this true religion and this noble religion, Allah has made it that Iman, which we translate as faith, Iman we translate it as faith. But when we use the word faith in the English language, it has a meaning of a belief, something that is inside, some idea that you have, some opinion that you hold. Whereas in Islam, there is a direct connection between what you believe and what you do. There is a direct connection between your belief and your actions. That faith is of no real consequence. Belief is of no real importance unless that belief is linked to actions. If you truly believe in Allah, and you truly believe in the Day of Judgment, and you truly believe in the Paradise, and you truly believe in the Hellfire, then this belief should affect the way that you behave. So the person performs actions that are righteous and that increases their Iman. And a person commits sins, acts of disobedience to Allah, and that causes their Iman to decrease. So part of the purpose of our existence, part of the reality of Ibadah. Ibadah means what? What is Ibadah? Again, we translate it as worship. We translate it as worship, but this term worship that we use for Ibadah is not at all an adequate way of explaining or describing the concept of Ibadah in Islam. Ibadah is in fact everything which Allah, the Creator, God, loves. Ibadah is everything which Allah loves. Whether it is from the actions of the heart or the actions of the limbs. Everything which Allah loves, everything which Allah approves of, whether it is the action of the heart or the action of the limbs, this is Ibadah. So the purpose of life, the reason for our existence, is to try to make every action that we do, whether it is an action of the heart or an action of the limbs, an action that Allah loves and approves of. And it is also to avoid and keep away from all of those actions, whether they are the actions of the heart or the actions of the limbs, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates and He disapproves of. So those actions that Allah loves, they are called actions of Ibadah. And the actions that Allah hates, they are called sins. It's what we call sins. So the sins encompass those actions which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates and He disapproves of. And sins, just like Ibadah, has levels. And there are some actions of Ibadah that are superior to others. There are also some sins which are more great and more severe and incur more the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than others. So sins also have levels. So there are the sins that are major sins, and there are sins that are lesser sins. When the scholars try to define the major sins. What are the major sins? Then the scholars differed about this. Some said there are 4, some 5, some 20, some 17, some... they differed. In fact, there are different narrations from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying the major sins are this and the major sins are that. In fact, these are not a contradiction. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in these narrations did not mean to say that these are all of the major sins, only he was describing some of the sins that are major sins. However, Abdullah ibn Abbas, his opinion was that the major sins consist of everything which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has threatened the committing of that sin with a punishment, or with the hellfire, or with his curse. And Abdullah ibn Abbas also said something, subhanAllah, that really shows the depth and the quality of understanding that this great scholar possessed. He said, major sins are 700 in number instead of only 7. However, it is not the number of major sins that is counted. It is the treatment. True repentance with firm resolution and determination will rub off major sins from the record of deeds. Whereas haughtiness, pride, will not rub off even a minor sin. And there is a saying of the scholars, and it is a saying, brothers and sisters, that we should think about it deeply. Do not think so much as to whether the sin is a minor sin or a major sin. Rather consider the majesty and the holiness and the greatness of the one against whom the sin is being committed. Sometimes you hear a brother say, oh, but it's not really a big sin. And the sister will say, oh, but it's not really a big sin. But brothers and sisters, we should think. We should think to ourselves that what is taking place when we commit a sin? What in fact is our action saying to our Lord? What does in fact our action proclaim to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? In reality, when we commit a sin, we have taken the prohibition of Allah lightly. There is something that Allah has forbidden us from and prohibited us from. Yet we go ahead and we do that thing which Allah has prohibited us from. Brothers and sisters, we have to understand a very important fact. Allah does not need us to worship Him. Allah does not need us to pray or to fast or to remember Him. He loves that we should do it, but He does not need it because He is self-sufficient. And it makes no difference to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you commit sins. It makes no difference to Him in the sense that it does not increase or decrease His power in the slightest. If all of us, the men, the women, the jinn, if we were to gather together in one place, and all of us, that our soul was to be as wicked as the most wicked soul amongst us, it would not decrease the kingdom of Allah any more than if you took a needle and you dipped it in the sea and you see what is left. It does not make any difference to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It does not make Allah less powerful. It does not decrease His kingdom in the slightest. Allah has only prohibited something to us, and Allah has only ordered something for us, because He knows from His wisdom and His knowledge that this thing that He has prohibited is bad for us. It is detrimental to either our soul, or our bodies, or our families, or our societies. It is something that is hateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because it is detrimental to our own selves. And Allah hates that we should destroy ourselves and we should harm ourselves. Allah loves that we should benefit ourselves with goodness and righteousness, and the things that He knows from His knowledge are beneficial for us in this life and the next. And Allah hates that we should harm ourselves and bring evil to ourselves in this life and the next. And also, brothers and sisters, we should think that Allah is the wise. And Allah is the one who has honor and dignity, and Allah is most worthy and has the most right to honor and dignity, to izzah, honor. And that Allah hates that the human being should disobey Him and rebel against Him and oppose His command. Because this means, brothers and sisters, that we are taking Allah lightly. We are not giving Allah the respect that is due to Him. We have failed to comprehend really how truly wise and knowledgeable and caring Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. It is as if we have really not cared. And it is almost as if we have said that we know better. So brothers and sisters, the sins, the large ones and the small ones, they are something that we must avoid. Allah has forbidden them because they are harmful to us. And that it is from Allah's mercy, His infinite mercy to us and His kindness to us, that He sent to us guidance from Himself, from His knowledge, to teach us the path of goodness and to warn us from the path of destruction, to teach us the means to real success in this life and the next, and to warn us away from the path of destruction in this life and the next. That is from Allah's great mercy and blessing to us. That is why He sent the Qur'an. Alif Lam Mim. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِي هُدًّا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ Alif Lam Mim. This is the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, the second chapter of the Qur'an. Alif Lam Mim. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِي. This is the book without any doubt. هُدًّا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. Guidance for the muttaqeen. Guidance for those who have taqwa. It is a book of guidance, to teach us what is right from what is wrong, to teach us what is good from what is evil. Lil muttaqeen, for the muttaqeen. They are the people who have taqwa. What is taqwa, brothers and sisters? What is taqwa? Sometimes you find it translated as fear of Allah or God consciousness. Abu Huraira described the person who has taqwa. He gave a beautiful description. He said, have you ever walked upon a path that is strewn with thorns? You know, a path that has thorns all over it. And I think it was Umar. He said, yes. He said, how did you walk on that path? He said, I was careful to avoid the thorns, and I picked my way carefully along that path. And Abu Huraira said, this is taqwa. This is taqwa. The person goes through life being careful to avoid the things that harm them. And the things that harm them are the sins, So this is the person who has taqwa. They go through life taking care to avoid the harmful things, the sins. So brothers and sisters, we want to talk today about those major sins that are neglected. Unfortunately, we have to say that the Muslims have neglected nearly all of the major sins. In fact, if you were to look through the books that list the major sins, you will find these sins existing amongst the Muslims in really large numbers. You will not find that there is one of the major sins except that you will find it present amongst the Muslims. And not only present in a hidden manner, unfortunately present in an open manner. However, what we have decided to do today is to pick some of those major sins and discuss about them. And the first of the major sins, and the ones I have chosen to discuss, are sins that people often don't realize are major sins. There are many major sins that we know that everybody, I think, they knows they are major sins. For example, everyone knows that fornication is a major sin. Adultery is a major sin. Homosexuality is a major sin. Drinking alcohol is a major sin. Stealing is a major sin. Murdering is a major sin. I think nearly everybody knows that these are major sins. Even I think the non-Muslims know that these are major sins. So there are some sins that are acknowledged really by everybody everywhere as being things that are harmful and detrimental and evil. So we don't really want to talk about those things, that even though we may commit them, and there are many Muslims unfortunately committing them, but we don't want to talk about those, because it's well known these are major sins. What we want to talk about is some of the major sins that usually people never even imagined that they are major sins. In fact, sometimes people even think that these things are permissible. And the first major sin that I want to talk about is speaking about Allah and His religion without knowledge. This is the first major sin that I want to talk about, is speaking about Allah and His religion without knowledge. In fact, brothers and sisters, this sin is so high on the list of major sins that some scholars said it is worse than shirk. Some scholars said it is worse than shirk. And shirk, from those who are familiar with the Qur'an, they will know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, the meaning of which is that He will forgive any sin that He wills, but He will never forgive shirk. And that the people who commit shirk, that Allah has forbidden paradise for them, and the hellfire will be their eternal abode. So, for most people who have even the beginnings of knowledge, they know that the greatest sin, and the only sin that is unforgivable, and that Allah will never forgive, meaning, by the way, if you die having not repented. Because every sin Allah will forgive if you repent from it in this life. But this means if you die having not repented from it. So if you die having not repented from making shirk, and you die upon shirk, then Allah will not forgive you. And Allah will not admit that person to paradise, and they will go to hell forever, and they will never ever come out. So how could there be a sin that is worse than shirk? How could speaking about Allah and His religion be worse than shirk? Because the worst sin, and the only sin that is unforgivable, is shirk. And the reason the scholars said that, brothers and sisters, is because shirk only comes into existence in the first place when people speak about Allah and His deen without knowledge. If the people only spoke about God, about Allah and His religion according to the truth that He had revealed to the messengers, then shirk would never have existed in the first place. But shirk came about, and shirk comes about, shirk being ascribing partners and setting up rivals to God in His lordship, in His names and attributes, and in His worship. That this only happens because people speak about Allah and His religion without knowledge. So they say that because shirk originates from that, it is even worse than shirk. Because it is that thing which causes shirk to happen. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning. He mentioned in Surah Al-A'raf, in the 33rd ayah, the meaning of which is, say, certainly, my Lord has forbidden only indecencies, fawahish, indecencies. These are open sins, like illicit sexual intercourse, and so on and so on, fawahish, both open and secret. So Allah has forbidden it, whether it is done openly or secretly. And Allah has prohibited ithm, the sins, and oppression, and تَقُولُ عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, that you should speak about Allah without knowledge, or you should say that or something about Allah that you do not know. So this is one of the major sins, speaking about Allah, about His religion without knowledge. And brothers and sisters, this is something that we find widely practiced amongst the Muslims. They speak about Allah and His deen without knowledge. Brothers and sisters, you do not understand how easy it is to give fatwa. Many of us, we give fatwa without even knowing that we are giving fatwa. What is fatwa? It is a verdict, a religious ruling. In fact, to be precise, giving a fatwa is saying, this is what Allah has allowed, and this is what Allah has forbidden. How many times do you hear people say, oh, this is in the Qur'an, and that is in the Qur'an, and the Qur'an says this, and the Qur'an says that, which is the same as saying, Allah says this, and Allah says that. And in fact, this thing, you look the Qur'an from beginning to end, you'll never find it. How many times have I heard people say that? How many times do you hear people say, in Islam we do this, and in Islam we do that, although in fact, this thing is not from Islam at all. Sometimes it is from their culture or their traditions, and sometimes it is even the opposite of what Islam says. All of this is saying that this is what Allah has revealed, and this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordained, and this is speaking about Allah and His deen without knowledge. If someone comes to you and says to you, oh, what do you think about this and what do you think about that? Asking you, what do you think is the Islamic position and the Islamic position on this and that? And you say, well, I think this and I think that. That is fatwa. You are giving a fatwa. And some people even think. But it is good that they sit down, they open the Qur'an, they read the Qur'an, maybe not even in Arabic. And even if they read it in Arabic, maybe they don't even understand what the words say. And they will read the translation and they will say, okay brothers and sisters, I think this means that. What do you think it means? And they say, well, I think it means this. And I think it means that. And I think it means this. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Talking about Allah and His deen and His revelation without knowledge. When you say, I think it means this and that, is you're giving your opinion. It's like you're giving a fatwa. Subhanallah. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he was asked, what is your opinion about the Qur'an? And he said, what sky will shelter me and what earth will hold me that if I give my opinion about the Qur'an? The Qur'an is not a book that should be interpreted according to our opinions. It is not permissible to give your opinion. We have to know what is the explanation according to the revelation. What did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say about this verse? What did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explain that the meaning of this verse is? What have the people of knowledge stated concerning this verse? This is what we want to know. We are not allowed to put forward our opinion. And this, brothers and sisters, is a major, major sin. As we said, the scholars said, it is worse than shirk. Because it is what leads to shirk. And shirk comes from this. And this reminds us of what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. That Allah will take away the knowledge, not by taking away the knowledge from the hearts, but Allah will take away the scholars. He will take away the ulama. Allah will take away the scholars. This is how the knowledge will be taken away. And then only the ignorant people will remain. And the people will ask them for fatwa, for religious rulings, and they will give religious rulings. And they will misguide themselves and they will misguide others. So brothers and sisters, I warn myself and I warn yourselves against speaking about Allah and His religion without ilm, without knowledge. The second thing, my brothers and sisters, that we want to talk about is arrogance and pride. Is arrogance and pride. What is pride? What is pride? Kibr. What is kibr? Pride. One of the companions came and he asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is it pride? Is it from pride that I love to wear beautiful shoes? In fact, he said, O Messenger of Allah, I love and I like it that I have the most beautiful shoes. I don't like to see anyone that who has more beautiful shoes than me. Is that pride? Is that pride? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah is beautiful and He loves what is beautiful. Pride is to reject the truth when it comes to you and to look down upon people. Pride is to reject the truth when it comes to you and to look down upon people. To consider yourself superior to them. To look down upon them. This is pride, brothers and sisters. And really, if we think about this, really, we will become frightened. We will become really frightened. To reject the truth when it comes to you. How many of us are like that? How many of us are so convinced that our culture, our opinions, our group, our party, our nationality, that these are right and correct? That we have an idea about something, and we are so convinced that our idea and our opinion is correct, but somebody comes to us and they prove to us that Allah said, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith that is authentic, and the scholars explain this to be like that, and they bring us dalil, evidence. Dalil is قال الله وقال رسول, Allah said and the Messenger said, and they show us that our opinion is a wrong opinion and a false opinion. It is merely culture or our whims or our desires or something that we have taken from our mind or something that we have misunderstood. But instead of saying سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا, we hear and we obey, we become like those rebellious people, those disobedient people, those people who, when their messenger came to them and told them and commanded them with something, they heard and they disobeyed. Those people who worship the calf. Those people who, when Musa said to them, let us go and fight, they said, you go with your Lord and fight. In fact, it is like shaitan. The first sin that we know, the great sin that we know about from the Qur'an that was committed, the first sin that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about, that was committed, that we know about, was pride. It was the pride of shaitan when Allah commanded him to bow down before Adam, and he refused from pride, because he was haughty, he was proud, he was arrogant. Brothers and sisters, whoever has an atom's weight of pride will never enter paradise. Whoever has one atom's weight of pride, it doesn't mean that you like to drive a nice car. It doesn't mean that you like to have nice shoes or beautiful clothes. That's not pride. Allah is beautiful and He loves what is beautiful. But pride, brothers and sisters, is when the truth comes to you. When the truth, when Allah's command comes to you and you rebel and you refuse and you remain upon your way knowing that it is falsehood, this is pride. And that you look down upon other people and you consider other people less than you, and you are contemptuous towards them and condescending towards them, that is a very dangerous way of behaving. That is indeed amongst the major sins. So whoever, brothers and sisters, has an atom's weight worth of pride, they will not enter paradise. So without doubt, this is amongst the greatest of the major sins. And again, brothers and sisters, it is something that we find all too common and all too frequent. It is something, whenever I think about that, it frightens me. And I realize that, subhanAllah, becoming Muslim was only the beginning of the test. When you become Muslim and you choose to be a Muslim, and at some stage in your life, all of you have had to choose to be a Muslim. When you do that, in reality, the test is only really beginning. Because knowledge will come to you. What Allah says and what the Messenger of Allah says will come to you. And how many times we turn away in pride. Oh, I don't like that. I don't like that, what that says.
I don't like this polygamy in Islam, sisters. Seriously? SubhanAllah. How many things that Allah has ordered us with, brothers? We don't like it. We turn away from it. We feel some dislike for it in our heart. SubhanAllah. It is not possible that if you believe in Allah and the last day, that you could have hatred for anything that has been revealed by Allah to the Messenger. SubhanAllah, it is not possible that you could dislike something that Allah has revealed from this deen. Yes, you may find it difficult. You may find it difficult to do. But SubhanAllah, it is kufr. Because if it's not kufr to find it difficult, but to dislike it, to hate it, that is kufr. Why? Because you are therefore believing that what Allah has ordered you with is not good for you. Even though Allah has said that what He has ordered you with is good, and what He has prohibited you from is bad. How therefore can you hate anything from Islam? How could you hate any sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? How? Because that means that you do not believe that what Allah has revealed is good for you. SubhanAllah. This is very dangerous. And if you think about it, brothers and sisters, you will see. And you will not therefore be surprised when you look at the Muslim Ummah and you see the condition in which we find ourselves. The feeble condition and the state in which we find ourselves. No, we have become like those people who came before us. We pick what we like and we leave what we don't like. Oh, I like this bit and I like this bit and I like this bit from Islam, but I don't like this bit. So I'll take that and I'll leave that. Picking and choosing. And that in reality is rejecting the guidance. That in reality is pride and arrogance. And it is not possible that a true Muslim could be such a way and be in such a manner. This pride is one of the actions of the heart. If some people were wondering, what is an action of the heart? Pride and humility, they are actions of the heart. Another major sin, and it is more than a major sin, because these things I'm mentioning now are actually acts of kufr, and I'm just selecting some. There are many others. And in fact, like I said, you will find that there is hardly a thing that Allah has prohibited except you find the Muslims doing it. But one thing I thought is worth mentioning, in fact, I would say it is important to mention it, brothers and sisters, especially in this time, is the action of supporting the disbelievers against the Muslims. Supporting the disbelievers against the Muslims is in fact kufr. It is disbelief. This is something that has been clearly stated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Qur'an. That to aid the unbelievers against the believers is an act of kufr, of disbelief. It is an act of disbelief. It is an act of nifaq, hypocrisy. Someone may point out, quite rightly, that there was one companion of the Prophet who fought at Badr, whose name I don't remember. But this companion, he fought at the Battle of Badr. And you know what the Prophet said about the people of Badr? Do what you like, Allah is forgiving you. But, of course, being Sahaba, they didn't behave like that. But this one companion, when the Prophet was about to attack Mecca, was about to attack Mecca, he sent a letter to his relatives there. Or he sent a letter to the mushrikun, warning them about that. And this letter was intercepted. When they found it was from the Sahaba, some other Sahaba wanted to kill him for his disbelief. And he said, O Messenger of Allah, all of you have some relative and somebody in Mecca to protect their families. But my family, we have no one. O Messenger of Allah, I did not do this from hatred of Islam or wanting to support the kuffar in my heart. It was only out of the concern for my family. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forgave him. Of course, we know from this, when we say that supporting the kuffar against the Muslims is an act of kuffar, it is not therefore upon you and me to start going around proclaiming that some people we seem, in our opinion, seem to be helping the kafir against the Muslims, to say they're kuffar, they're not Muslims. It's not permissible to do that, because that itself, by the way, is a major sin. To say about a Muslim, oh kafir, to say about a Muslim, you are a kafir, then as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, then one of the two of you will be a kafir. Whoever says about a Muslim, oh kafir, one of the two of you will be a kafir. If it is not true about your accusation, then it will come down upon the one who made that accusation. It is a major sin to accuse a Muslim of being a kafir. However, I say this by a warning. And some brothers and sisters may say, subhanAllah, what's this got to do with us? How would we support the kuffar against the Muslims? Brothers and sisters, you can support the kuffar against the Muslims even by a word. It doesn't mean that you say, don't worry, you can use my country for air bases only. That's not the only way you can support the kuffar against the Muslims. Not only that you say, don't worry, we will fight with you, O America and Britain, and we will fight with you against the Muslims. Yes, this is an act of kuffar, to help the kuffar against the Muslims. But even, brothers and sisters, by a word, even by a word, even by some statement that you can make. For example, slandering and attacking the Muslims unjustly, such as you find many Muslims have done this about the Taliban. Slandering them and attacking them and reviling them based upon news that has come from the disbelieving media. Helping the kuffar against the Muslims. This, I have to warn you, it could be an act of kufr, brothers and sisters, that could take you out of Islam. SubhanAllah. In some way or another, even by a word, even maybe by a sign. And I say this, brothers and sisters, because this is something, unfortunately, the Muslims have completely neglected and failed to comprehend this fundamental point of our belief and our religion. That our alliance and our allegiance is to the believers. Our wala is to the believers, and our adha, our enmity, is to the disbelievers. Because the Muslims are the people of Iman, the people of Islam. The people who have chosen to obey Allah, to leave shirk, to submit themselves to what Allah revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the disbelievers are those people who have chosen to rebel against that. And that is the worst rebellion. That is the worst type of rebellion. The worst type of disobedience. And this is something essential to the teachings of Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He told us, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةً. Verily the believers are brothers. The believers are a single brotherhood. We are like the bricks of the building supporting each other. If one part, we are like a single body. If one part of the body feels pain, the whole of the body is restless and sleepless. This is how we should be. This is our condition. So brothers and sisters, I warn you against this oft-neglected major sin of aiding and abetting and helping the disbelievers against the believers. This is a sure sign of hypocrisy, of pure hypocrisy. Another thing, brothers and sisters, that I feel is important to mention concerning the oft-neglected major sins, and again, when we say a major sin, What we're talking about here is indeed an action of kufr, and that is practicing magic. Either practicing magic, or seeking help, or seeking the aid of one who practices magic, and even being sympathetic to the practice of magic is an action of clear kufr, of clear disbelief. It is something that removes you and takes you out of Islam. And this is something, brothers and sisters, that is very dangerous. Now we have Harry Potter flying around in his broomstick. And we have Lord of the Rings. And all so many things. And Buffy the Vampire Slayer. And Sabrina the Teenage Witch. And the kids sit in front of there and say, "Oh, it's Sabrina, put on Sabrina. Oh, Harry Potter's my favorite film." But you know, brothers and sisters, it may all seem innocent, but in reality, all of these things are promoting magic and the practice of magic and the practice of the occult. There is no such thing as good magic and bad magic, white magic and black magic. All magic is bad, because every person who practices magic is given the ability to do it, or shaitan will help that person because of an action or a statement of kufr that they have made. They will have to do something of kufr. Maybe they will sit on the Qur'an, tread on the Qur'an, worship an idol, or commit some act of kufr. And when they do that, the shayateen will aid them and help them in their magic. And it doesn't matter, even if the man, he prays and he fasts, and they say he is a holy man. If he is practicing magic, then this is all a pretense, and he is only using the shayateen, and this is because he has committed some act of kufr. Sometimes you find Muslims will go to what they believe is a holy man, but in fact he is writing the verses of the Qur'an in pig's blood. He is doing something or some action of kufr, and through that the shayateen and the jinn help him. And this is widespread amongst the Muslims, as you know it. People go and they go to magicians and they go to these people who are considered sometimes to be holy men, sheikhs or peers, as they call them in Urdu, peers, sheikhs. I don't mean the good religious sheikhs, but these imposters. Sometimes they claim to have the knowledge of the unseen. And this is another major sin, in fact, also an action of kufr. To go to fortune tellers, to soothsayers, to people who you believe will tell you what is going to happen to you in the future. Also, again, some of these people pose as righteous men. In fact, we have heard stories of people who go to these sheikhs and they say, and this is a story that I've heard, that one couple, they went to see this sheikh and their daughter was sick and she was in the car. And they came and sat in front of him, and they said, and the first thing he said to them, "Why did you leave your sick daughter in the car?" He said, "How did you know that?" And then he will tell them about their problems. He may even say, "You are pregnant and you are expecting, and there's no sign." He may tell them about their problems in their life, that you are suffering marital problems and this and that. Even we have heard stories of one brother, he told me how he went to a man who was supposed to be a holy man in Pakistan. He traveled many miles from Karachi to some remote village. And the moment he stepped through the door and sat down, this man produced, the so-called holy man, produced a packet of his favorite cigarettes. Yes. And in fact, he told me that these cigarettes are almost impossible to find in Pakistan. And he said to him, "This is your favorite cigarette, isn't it?" Yeah. How did he know? How did he know that? They know these things because they work with the shayateen and the jinn. And they only do that because of their kufr. But people say, oh, they have ilm al-ghayb. They have knowledge of the unseen. And they make shirk with Allah. Because Allah, only Allah is alim al-ghaybi. Only Allah is knower of the unseen. And Allah does not give knowledge of the unseen except to His chosen messengers. And this is how the shayateen deceive people. And how many brothers and sisters open up the morning newspaper, maybe the sisters more than the brothers. The brothers, we know they go to the back pages and say, what's the footy happening today? And maybe the sisters, some of them, Allahu A'lam, I hope not, they go to Auntie Jemima's horoscope page. Oh, I'm a Pisces, what's in store for me today? You will meet a handsome stranger. Big changes are going to happen in your life today. But you might feel a little bit depressed at times. Oh, it's so true. How did Auntie Jemima get it so right? And although we laugh, brothers and sisters, it's really not funny, because this is an act of kufr. Even to turn to the horoscopes out of curiosity, your prayers will not be accepted for 40 days. Yes. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever visits a fortune teller and believes in what they have said, disbelieves in what Allah revealed to Muhammad. Whoever visits a fortune teller and believes in what they said, disbelieves in what Allah revealed to Muhammad. And whoever visits them out of curiosity, Allah will not accept their prayers for 40 days. Means their prayer, the obligation of prayer is still upon them, but their prayer will not be accepted for 40 days. And brothers and sisters, there's one thing I want to mention, although tomorrow there's going to be a whole talk dedicated to this. And that is abandoning the obligatory prayers. Abandoning the obligatory prayers. In fact, according to some scholars, but we will talk about this tomorrow, we're not going to talk about it today, only to mention that some scholars have said that the person who purposefully leaves prayer actually leaves the fold of Islam. So that is something that we'll talk about tomorrow, inshallah. The next major sin that we want to talk about, and this is the first of the major sins, that brothers and sisters, is not something that makes you a disbeliever. All of these things that we have talked about so far can all make you a disbeliever. If you die having upon these things without repenting, then you are in danger of going to the hellfire forever and never coming out. However, now what we want to talk about is some other major sins that are less than that, but they are still very severe. And the first of them that we want to talk about, and this is something, brothers and sisters, many people neglect. And this is riya. Showing off. That we do our deeds not for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but we do our deeds either in order to impress people, to get their admiration, to get their praise, or to please them, or we may do this action for some worldly benefit and worldly gain. For example, one makes Hajj not with the intention of performing the pilgrimage, but the intention of doing business. Meaning that is your intention. Then this is riya, this is what is called lesser shirk. Because you are doing an action that should only be for Allah, and you're doing it for other than Allah, for something other than Allah. It does not take you out of Islam, but it is a major, major sin. Indeed, on the Day of Judgment, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that the first three people that will be brought before Allah on the Day of Judgment is a scholar, a martyr, and a charitable person. So the one who will be brought first, he will be one who had died fighting jihad. And Allah will say to him, what did you do with the bounties that I gave to you? And he will say, "Oh Allah, I fought jihad in your path until I was killed a martyr. And I did it for your sake, for your pleasure." And Allah will say, "You lied. You fought jihad so that the people would call you brave and a fighter. And they called you that." And Allah will order him to be dragged on his face to the hellfire. And another man will come, and Allah will say to him, "What did you do with the bounties that I bestowed upon you?" And he will say, "Oh Allah, I learnt Qur'an, and I learnt religious knowledge. And I did that for your sake, for your pleasure." And Allah will say, "You lied. You learnt to recite the Qur'an so that people will call you a reciter. And you learned knowledge so that the people will call you an alim. And they called you that." And Allah will order him to be dragged on his face to the hellfire. And then a man will come, and Allah will say to him, "What did you do with the bounties that I gave to you?" And he will say, "Oh Allah, there was not a place where I could spend money in your cause, except I spent money in your cause for the sake, for your pleasure and for your sake." And Allah will say to him, "You lied. You spent money so that people will call you generous. And they called you that." And Allah will order him to be dragged on his face into the hellfire. These are the first three people that will be brought in front of Allah on the Day of Judgment. Oh brothers and sisters, look how these individuals did the best of deeds. Jihad, knowledge, and giving charity. They are amongst the best of the deeds. Yet they did not do those deeds for Allah's pleasure. They did those deeds so people will speak well about them. So that people will say, "He's brave, he's knowledgeable, he's charitable." So their deeds and the fact that they spent their life doing those things did not benefit them at all. Rather, it was a great sin that they committed for which they are punished in the hellfire. So brothers and sisters, sincerity in our deeds is of the utmost importance. We have to make sure that we do our deeds purely and sincerely for the pleasure of Allah. The companions of the Prophet used to consider that shirk al-asghar or riya, they used to consider it more serious than the major sins like drinking alcohol and fornicating, and as we mentioned, the ones that we all know. They used to consider insincerity worse, because the insincerity in the deed is a type of shirk. And shirk, even if it is a lesser shirk, is worse than a major sin. So brothers and sisters, this is something that we have to take care of. In fact, they used to consider, the companions, they used to spend as much time trying to make their deed sincere as they would spend doing the deed itself. They were as concerned with sincerity in their actions as they were concerned with the action itself. So the action, brothers and sisters, has to be sincere, and also it must be correct. Meaning it must be according to the way that Islam has told it, or the way that the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ has taught us. The action has to be sincere and correct. If it is sincere and it is not correct, the action will not be accepted. And if the action is correct but it is not sincere, it will not be accepted. The actions, the ibadah, the acts of worship will only be accepted when they are both sincere and correct. And this is why, brothers and sisters, you will see why some people talk about a lot jihad al-nafs. Because if you do not fight the jihad against yourself, one of those things is to make sure that your actions are sincere, then all the other actions are of no benefit on the Day of Judgment. What is the benefit if we go and we fight and die in the battlefield, but we did it because, oh, I want everyone to think I'm a martyr, I'm brave, I'm strong? It's of no benefit, brothers and sisters. That's why we have to conquer our own passions and desires. We do not do things because we want people to think how good we are, how great we are, how good we are, how charitable we are, how pious we are. Oh, look how I pray, everybody. Delaying it, making the Qur'an more beautiful. Not to please Allah, but to please others. This is very, very dangerous. The other often neglected major sin, there's no way I can finish in 2 minutes. The other often neglected major sin that we have to mention, and it is very important, and in fact, some people do not even consider this a sin, again, they think this is something good, is innovation. Is innovation, bid'ah. Innovation, brothers and sisters, is extremely serious. Indeed, the Prophet ﷺ has told us, and we mentioned in the beginning of this speech, as we mentioned in the beginning of every speech, خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الحدي حدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. The worst thing and the worst of the actions of the innovation, the new actions, the new invented matters in the religion, and every bid'ah, every newly invented matter, every kulla bid'atin dalala, every innovated action is dalala.